Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, I start to fall. And all those lonely roads that I traveled on, there was Jesus when the life I built came crashing to the ground. Where the friends I had were nowhere to be found. Didn't know you then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus in the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment of where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know or I couldn't see it, there was Jesus. For this man who needs amazing kind of grace, for forgiveness and a price I couldn't pay.
Good morning, Community Life Church. I am Kat Seiler, the Director of Adult Discipleship here, and we are so honored that you've decided to join us on this blustery morning, whether you are here in person or if you're home still in your pajamas, that's totally okay. Thank you for joining us. We have a couple quick announcements just before we get things rolling. We have our Thrive Groups, Classes, and Studies to be kicking off mid-September. So registration opened up 15 August, and so we encourage you to stop by the Thrive Wall, find a life group, find a Bible study, and just get connected. We also have two of our ministries out in the lobby, Oasis, our seniors ministry, as well as Fifth Thursday, part of our women's ministry, and they both have some pretty awesome events coming up in September. So if you're interested in plugging into those, we encourage you to go talk to somebody and check it out. And now what we would ask is that you please rise, and we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Father God, every Sunday we come together and we pray this prayer. But how often do we actually think about these words and actually take them to heart? Father, there's so much that's going on beyond these doors, overseas, to the west of us. Life never stops coming, but you are sovereign. You are always constant. You are always there. You are always that joy that we so desperately need in this broken world. Father, we thank you for that. And we thank you for this time and this opportunity to come together, to listen to your word, and to draw closer to you. Father, we give up this day to you, and we do all of this in your Son, Jesus Christ, most holy, glorified, and precious name. Amen.
Amen. How many of you would say this morning that you are, you've got a bunch of stuff going on, and you're just believing God for a miracle in several different areas in your life? Anybody out there this morning praying and believing God for miracles? I know we've got a lot of heavy stuff these days, but you know what? Our trust and our hope is in Christ Jesus this morning. That's why we're here, to celebrate and honor him. So let's press in this morning and just worship and focus on the words and what they mean to you. And let's just let God be God today and do what he wants to do.
Shall come with trumpet sound.
Things that can often weigh us down, but Lord, help us really cling to what this message is, that the hope that we have is in Christ Jesus, and we don't always see you, we don't always understand what you're doing and how you're moving, but help us to trust you more and to lean into that today. In Christ Jesus this morning is your victory. Don't give up. I hope to encourage you this morning that if you're praying and believing, even if it's been years, just continue hanging in there and believing, knowing that God sees things and knows things that we could not ever possibly begin to understand. And he's moving pieces and puzzles and making it all happen. So put your faith in that, to know that he wants what's best for you today. And eventually, I believe we're going to see a victory, amen, over those things that we're praying about. Weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. Darkness holds, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I know knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. Sing that with confidence this morning. My God will never fail. My God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. Oh, One more time this morning.
What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name. Oh, what a name. The name of Jesus Christ. Oh, there's power in your name. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is, the name of.
One more time, what a beautiful.
What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Jesus, we lift your name high above any doubt that we might be experiencing. We lift you high above fear. This morning, we lift you high above depression. We lift you high above hopelessness. And especially the fear, Lord, of those things, of what's to come. God, help our eyes stay focused on you. It's so easy to be swayed by so many things that's going on. But we know that you are the one true God. And more than anything, God, you've got it. And so we just have to continue when things are falling apart to keep our eyes focused on you and not the storm and the things that are around us. We love you. We give you back this time. Move in this service through Pastor Scott's message today. Open our hearts to receive it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much, everybody, for singing. You can be seated.
Good morning. How are y'all doing today? You good? So good to see your smiling faces. I want to welcome you and thank you so much for joining us today at Community Life Church or for joining us online. I think a lot of people decided just to drag the iPad up onto the bed and turn it on this morning, and I can't blame you. We're glad to connect with you any way possible today. So thank you so much for just allowing us this time to connect with you. My name is Scott Veroneau, and I'm the lead pastor here at Community Life, and it is an honor to have you. At Community Life, we love God, we love our neighbor, and we believe that our mission is to connect people to Jesus because we believe that Jesus is the source of life. And there's a lot of challenging, difficulty things that we face in life. And if we can in any way stand alongside you and help connect you to Jesus, we would love to be able to do that. Tonight was supposed to be, this afternoon, we were supposed to have the children's baptism service on Navarre Beach. Aren't y'all glad we're not doing that today? Although they would have remembered their baptism at some particular point, but we're glad that we're not doing that. But that being said, the video that we just saw, on September 19th, we will have our sunrise baptism service on Navarre Beach. If you've not been baptized, or this is that time and season when you want to remember your baptism, this is a great way to do it. We all show up that Sunday morning at sunrise and just a little brief message, and then we just start baptizing people, and it is a great way to start the day and a great way to really just connect with your faith. And so would love to be able to do that with you. And so if you want to text CLC baptism to 94,000, that'll get you the link back to be able to do that. And then also for those who maybe are starting the church for the very first time, trying to find out some more information, coming up on the 12th, we have a luncheon where we just get to spend some time with you. You get to hear a little bit about the church. We get to hear a little bit about you. And if you want to sign up for that, that's the First Steps Luncheon. Text First Steps to 94,000. And then last but not least, I get the question every week because we don't talk about giving a whole lot, but we are a 501c3 and we're supported by your generosity. And so if you want to make a donation to the church or connect online, CLC giving, that's the keyword, text that to 94,000 and they'll send you back a form and you can fill that out. Or if you're diehard and you have to do checks or cash, there are boxes around by the doors. I know some of y'all, that's the way your mama taught you and that's the way you're going to be doing it forever. And so we appreciate that. Okay. So there's a little event going on to the south of us, the south and west, and it's called Hurricane Ida. Would you guys mind if we just took a second and prayed for all of our friends in Louisiana? Is that okay? Okay, let's go ahead and do that. Heavenly Father, we just take a moment, God, to think about all of the states to the west of us, Louisiana, Mississippi, parts of Alabama, even Texas. God, that are anticipating landfall of this hurricane. Lord, we've been there. We know the anxiety and what you start to feel as that storm approaches. And we just pray right now for your peace. God, we would love to see that hurricane diminish and the wind speed to fall and for the water to just start to recede. But Lord, we just pray that you would go before it and you would protect lives. It's a Sunday morning. This is when most people will be gathering to go to church. And this morning, they're without their faith community. But God, we are their faith community. And so today, we join our hearts together spiritually. And we pray as the body of Christ that you would protect and that you would love and that you would be there to care for those folks. And then, Lord, as the storm moves through, that as the body of Christ, we'd be able to respond and that we would literally put flesh on the gospel and we'd be there to help people to navigate through this. And so just bless and care for. There are so many of us here. Remember Hurricane Ivan and what that felt like. And so, God, we just lift them up today. Protect lives, protect hearts. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you all for allowing me to do that. And I'll just go ahead and tell you that for those in the building, I don't think it's as much of an issue for those that are online. As it starts raining, and as it will, it gets really loud in this building. Preaching in a metal building is so exciting. You will hear everything. And so Wayne is going to try and modulate the sound so that it works so that you can hear me. But it'll be a lot of fun this morning. See how that goes. But okay, so today we start our last sermon in this series that we've been going through called Flourish. And Flourish is our launching of the fall season sermon series. And what we're asking you to consider in this fall season is to, one decision at a time, choose God. To choose God and to wrestle through that choice and allow your choice to start to form and fashion and shape you in such a way that it starts to transform the world around you. We've just come out of a time and a season where we've gone through the book of Colossians and we've talked a lot about Paul. And to me, when I look at Paul, I love the fact that the way he used the gospel, or the way that the gospel used him, maybe that's a better way to say it, transformed the world. The way that we look at relationships and marriages and relationships with our children and with our spouse and how we negotiate families and friends. Paul started to shape all of that just by elevating and loving and caring for and offering a dignity to people and elevating their standing in society. He did that by introducing people to the gospel message and the God that loved them. And so for me, as I look around at this very broken and troubled world, I'm just crazy enough to believe that God has something to say to that world. And for me, once again, I want to be a part, not just for myself, but I want to be a part of the church, the body of Christ, of bringing about a transformation that helps to reshape this world. Now for me, I make no mistake, I believe in growing kingdom, and this world is going to go the direction that the world goes, and so we grow kingdom, but this kingdom can have an impact on the people that live right next door to you. And so this series, Flourish, is all about making a decision every single day to allow God to impact your life. Paul in Colossians referred to it as this: be rooted in Christ, grow up in Christ, and then be established in the faith So allow Christ to be your anchor that nourishes you, that allows you to grow. But don't just stop there. Make sure that you are established in a faith system with people around you that will hold you accountable, that will care for you, that will help you to grow in your life. I want to see that on a healthy way here in our community and the lives of the people that are around us. And so that's the journey that we're inviting you into. And so we've been looking at the book of Psalms, really in particular three. And we started in the first week looking at Psalm chapter one, and David, or the psalmist, I should say, presents you with this question. Are you going to seek the counsel of the wicked, or are you going to abide with God? Are you going to choose the wicked, or are you going to choose God? And so often in our faith, we think it's a one and done. You make that decision, you don't ever have to worry about it. Well, I think it's every single day that you wake up and you choose God for that day. And for me, that starts to transform your life. Maybe we need to ask that question more often than not. And so week one was make the decision, choose God in this life. And then week two, Psalm 19. This is a Psalm of David. And if you think of a target, an archery target, starting with the circle on the outside, he talks about creation being a way for you to get to know God. The whole Psalm is about being in relationship with God. That you can look in creation and you can have an awareness of God, that there is a revelation of God, but he refers to God in just a real general sense. The word he uses is the word El, which means God, just nothing in particular but God. And so you can look at creation and that can bring you into a relationship with God, but you can also study the law of Yahweh. He changes the word, and you can get to this intimate moment of recognizing who God is and learn about God. And it brings you into a deeper, closer relationship with God. But even David in Psalm 19, as he goes through talking about the law starts to reveal inside of him his own brokenness. And he cries out, he says, God, in those moments when I sin and I don't even know it, be there to protect me, be my redeemer. And so when you start to study God and you start to look at the law, it reveals our brokenness. And here's the big decision, our need for God. And when you get to that point in life, that's when you truly, when you choose God and you know your need for God, that's when you are in that relationship and you start to really develop a depth of relationship and a depth of connection with God. And so you could see that moving in. So week one was choosing God. Week two was getting to know God and moving into that intimate relationship. And this week we're opening up and we're going to look at Psalm 27. And this is kind of that next step. The reality of life moving forward, yes, it has to do with getting to know God better, but what does it look like? How does our faith hit the ground and some of the things that we wrestle with? And so I'll just tell you that when I knew I was going to be teaching on Psalm 27, so a few weeks ago, I read the first verse. And let me just go ahead and I'll say it. I'll read it for you now. First verse is this. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And I remember a few weeks ago thinking, man, the world is a hot mess. And this is a great verse to look at because David has something to say to us about the things in life that are so problematic. And even though we face them, if we're anchored in God, why would we be afraid of any of that stuff? Right? So we come into this week and Monday, Clint and I would get on an airplane and we try to do this annually. We fly to Montana and we go hike mountains and we go fly fishing during the day. And then at night and in the mornings, we lay out all the sermon series stuff for 2022 and we pray and we work through the organization and we do all of those fun things. It was cold, by the way, y'all. It was beautiful. But then we move back into civilization and I start to hear the news and I hear about what's going on in Afghanistan and 13 of our best once again lost. And then you hear about the COVID numbers blowing up. And then there's this little storm off our coast. And I read this verse and I thought, oh God, and this is the most relevant psalm for us to think about all the problems in life and all of these things that we're facing. I think it's so important for us to know that if we can anchor our heart in the right place, then we can be secure and face those things with a faith that will withstand them. So I look forward to going through this because I think David really gives us some keys today that will help us to unpack life and to face and to wrestle with a real, true, solid faith, and not one that's going to cave in, I think, when the challenges come, but understanding the difficulties of life and facing them head on. There are, I don't know if this is how you'd break up the psalm, but I've broken it up really into four different sections. So verses 1 through 3, this is the declaration that he makes. so strong about what he believes. And then verses 4 and 5, this is when he speaks to, he makes one request that as a result of that request allows him to believe that. Verses 6 through 13, it's him living it out. And really living out that request that he makes. And then he has a final statement for us that just causes us to wrestle with the entirety of the psalm. So let's just dive into it and see how far we can get. So Psalm 27, verses 1 through 3. I'll read that and we'll talk about that section. David writes this. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and my foes, they shall stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident. And so he starts off with this big proclamation. The Lord is my light and my salvation. The Lord is my stronghold. I think it's important to go ahead and say, if you weren't here last week, the name that he uses for the Lord is a very personal name. He uses the name Yahweh. And so David is making a proclamation, not just about a God or any God, it's his God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This is his lineage, the one that he's connected to. And so David is talking from a source of experience or from a connection that he has as he's laying out this truth for us. So Yahweh is my light and my salvation and my stronghold. So those two things, light and salvation and stronghold. The word light is something that is just a part of our vernacular whenever we talk, and whenever we speak. And I don't know if we're even aware of how much we use it, right? Like you ever talk about somebody who's confused and you're like, they're just in the dark, right? Like that's how we think about it. So for David to say, he is my light, think of the influence of light in our lives or even in creation. When God said, let there be light, it brought order into the chaos. It started to establish and allow things to come into order. Have you ever got up in your room in the middle of the night and tried to walk around and get to the bathroom without waking everybody up, and you end up in the hospital because you tripped and you fell into the dresser or something crazy like that? Oh, maybe you haven't. I've come close. It ended up wounded. But the light is so important because it reveals for you the things that are in front of you. So light and salvation, this is David's relationship with God in a beautiful way that starts to reveal for him the truth of the connection of who God is to him. That it's not just some random God, that it's been revealed to David this greater connection. And stronghold, or refuge. He refers to God as a refuge, a place to hide, a place that will protect him. And so this is not just a one-sided relationship where David recognizes his love and his desire for God, but also the God that protects. And so you can see the beauty and the fullness of how all of this comes together. He goes on in verses 2 and 3, and it's interesting to me. He says, when evildoers assail me, though an army encamp against me. I think it's interesting, and David does this sometimes in his Psalms. He'll say, there's an army right outside, and they're coming to get me. This psalm is not that. This is him building his faith and preparing for what's going to happen in the future. When evildoers assail me, though an army encamp against me. In his mind, he is already imagining and knowing that these things are going to happen. And so he's preparing his faith. It's a faith that's ready for that worst case scenario to unfold. I mean, I can't tell you how many times in life that I'll sit in my office with people who are just shattered by the things that happen. And there are so many times in my heart I'm thinking, man, you didn't see this coming? Or there wasn't a part of your faith that just expected that maybe something like this would happen? Well, here, he's literally preparing himself, letting him know that if an army ever does come, this is what I believe about it, that I will not be afraid because of my faith and my trust in God. And so think about it in terms of hurricanes. If we know a hurricane's coming, we'll board up our windows. We'll prepare ourselves for that battle that's coming. He is establishing his faith and setting that strength ready to go for when those armies do come against him. And it's interesting to me that he sets up the worst case scenario. And in David's life, he faced all of these things. So for him to have his faith established, I think was so key for him. And then he moves into verses 4 and 5, and I'll just go ahead and read those. He says, one thing I ask of the Lord, that will I seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. And then he qualifies what that means, to dwell in the house of the Lord, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me, and if I do that, for he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent, and he will set me high on the rock. So he makes his grand statement that there's nothing that I'm going to fear. It doesn't matter if somebody comes against me, any of those things happen, but there's one thing that I ask, this one thing that will set me up and prepare me to face all of that. One thing that I request. And before I even go into teaching it, I wonder where our hearts are. What would be our one thing if God came and asked us? Would we be willing to ask for what David asked for, or are there other things that take prominence in our lives in the priority list? What's the one thing that means more to you than anything on the planet? Because David is going to establish for us what he believes that most important thing needs to be. It says, one thing that I asked of the Lord, one thing that I will seek after, is to live or to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Now, when you read that, you have to ask yourself the obvious question when you're going through scripture. Do you think this means that David wants to go live in the temple? Right? Does he really want to live and does he want to come and live a community life here in the gym and hang out with us every single day of his life? I mean, do you think that's what David was going for when he said that? And the answer is no. It wasn't a proximity to a particular place. For David, this was the presence of God that for him, it meant more than anything that he be in the presence of God all the days of his life, that he has that environment, that heart, that love, that connection with God all the days of his life. And then he goes on to qualify it. He says, number one, to behold the beauty of the Lord. And so that word behold, it can also be translated gaze. And so to look upon or to focus. I mean, say, Scott, what does that mean to look upon or to focus on God? There's a depth of relationship that's there, and we'll unpack it in a second. It's one thing to look. Remember last week we talked about creation. You can see God inside of all of that. This is a little deeper meaning than that. Or the second thing, to inquire in his temple, or to ask questions, or want to know more, right? So for David, to dwell in the house of God means these two things, to look upon and to inquire. And I looked at these two and just wrestled with them. What does that mean, to look upon and also to inquire? And you know, in relationships, and some of y'all will remember these moments in relationships. If you're married, if you had a spouse, if you've ever had that opportunity in your life where you look upon someone and you're like, oh, boy, they look good. You ever had that moment where you look and you're just like, they look good? And if that was what your relationship was established on, you could have a connection and maybe a level of love. But you can't be in a relationship for a long period of time if that is your only connection. There has to be the next step. There has to be the inquiry and the getting to know for there to be the depth of a relationship and a connection that goes beyond just that outside. Yes, we all want to see God. And we all want to know that God is present. But it's not just enough to recognize that there's a God. It's not just enough to see the hand of God. It's so much more to be in relationship, to get to know, to drive into, to inquire, to get to know that God. And so for David, those two parts go together in dwelling in the house of the Lord. It's not just enough to be aware of God, but also to be connected to God and get to know God and be in that relationship. And so I think that for me is really the hub behind the heart of what he's saying. If I have that, if that's the key focus of my life, then I don't need to be afraid of anything else. That I can continue to function forward, and I don't need to be afraid if that's the focus of who I am. And he follows that by saying in verse 5, for he will hide me in his shelter on the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will set me high on a rock. Now, this one thing he asks is so important for us to think about in life. Because we all have priorities and we all establish our one thing. And so what David does in this moment is he takes the ultimate thing, the eternal thing, and his request is that it be the most important thing of his life. And God, through the lens of this being my foundation and this being my truth, I can filter through and face everything else that's going to happen to me in life. But you know, for many of us, we've faced the antithesis where we've allowed something else to be the center core of our focus, something that's not eternal, whether it was relationship or whether it was finance or whether it was something else. And at some point, those things are going to fail and they're going to fall short. And then you're left with nothing, or you're left in a completely different stance with nothing to stand on. And so David says, one thing I ask is that I dwell in the house of the Lord forever, that I get to see God and that I get to know God. And that becomes the core focus of his life. And then verses 6 all the way through 13, I love this because it makes faith real. And I'll read it. He says, now, after that's happened, my head is lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Have you ever had those moments in life where you've recommitted your heart? Like maybe you went through a bad season. January 1, God, I'm going to worship. I'm going to pray every day. I'm going to read my scripture verse. And then January 1, 8 a.m. comes around, and you're like, yeah, I'll pass. Just going to do something different. You start out wanting to worship. You start wanting out to praise. This is David living this out. He says, my head is lifted up, all my enemies around me, and I will offer sacrifices and shouts of joy. I will sing and make a melody to the Lord. Verse 7, hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. How can a person who just established that God was going to defend him in any particular way, in every way, now find himself crying out to God and begging to be answered? But it doesn't seem to correlate with us unless you've walked through that in your life, unless you've had to face it where you have faith, but you also struggle. David finds himself in this very same spot. This is the reality of the gospel coming to life in our hearts. And then verse 8, his heart bursts forth. He says, come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, do I seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You who have been my help, do not cast me off. Do not forsake me, O God of my salvation. You can hear the struggle in all of that. If my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take me up. There's that faith that he has that God is going, that relationship is going to be more important. And then he opens up this topic in verse 11. Teach me your way, O Lord. And so we find in verse 8 and verse 11, once again, those two points that he makes in his request. His heart cries out, seek his face. And then in verse 11, the cry that comes out is teach me your way. And so the same way to gaze upon or to inquire, those two things come up. But now in these prayer, he's living them out in his life. And so you may say back in that verse 8, what does it mean to seek someone's face? You know, it's possible to know someone without really knowing them. And in our theology in the Christian church, in so many ways has struggled. And I'll tell you, we do this from time to time here on accident, but you ever heard somebody get up and pray and say, God, we welcome you into this place, or God, come and be with us, those kind of prayers? When the truth is, there's nowhere that you're going to be able to go that God is not present to you in that moment. So the better prayer is, God, I am aware of your presence, right? So theology is important in that particular moment. So for him to say, I seek your face, what's David saying, right? He already knows God. Why does he want to know God's face? You can come into this building and you can worship with Tammy and the band and you can hear their music and you can know them through their worship to a point. But to go sit down with them face to face, when you have those moments, there is a depth of relationship that is so beautiful. You start the revealing, the unpacking of your life and finding out it, and that's the cry of David's heart, that even in the struggle, the crying out of God, answer me, his heart screams out, I want to know your face. I want to recognize you, the lines, the wrinkles, every single part of that. And then the teach me your way, O Lord, this is where you get that second balance of how to function and go forward. Lead me on a level path because of my enemies. And God, show me how to live my life. Do not give me up to the will of my Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen up against me, and they are breathing out violence. So God, not only do I want to recognize you and see you face to face, I want you to teach me. Bring me along in this journey of life and allow me to get to know you. In verse 13, I love, he says, I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Once again, there's so many times that I'll sit with people and they're always convinced that if they would have done more, if they would have been better, if they would have prayed harder, then maybe there would have been a different outcome. And maybe there's truth somewhere in all of that, but I'm going to tell you, that's not the math equation that works out the way that I read in Scripture. In fact, David doesn't say I believe that I shall see exactly what I want from the Lord in the land of the living. What he says is, I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. That regardless of all of the challenges that I face, that I'm going to see the goodness of the Lord, that God is going to reveal himself to me, even in the brokenness, even in the challenges, that I'm going to experience the goodness of God. It doesn't mean I'm gonna get all the things I want. It doesn't mean that everything's gonna work out the way that I'm supposed to, but at some point, God's gonna reveal himself to me. One of the things that I love to point out is when we go through our scripture and we think about Paul and Peter and everybody that you've almost ever studied as far as the disciples go. My question is always, what did serving Jesus get them? Right? Like, you'd think those guys would have a palace and been living a problem-free, awesome life. When really serving God got them all martyred. It got them all killed. And so how do we come up with a theology that says that if we do more and we be more, then there's not ever going to be challenges in life? David is giving us a faith that's real. And if we can get to the place to where we can allow God to be that center focus, then he will reveal his goodness to us. And that faith will be a faith that can stand through all of it. And then verse 14, he says, wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. And so here's David, a warrior. And he uses two words, strong and courage. And he sandwiches them between two things that don't make sense, waiting on the Lord. Now, it doesn't make sense to me that if you wait on the Lord, you're going to be strong and you're going to be courageous, right? Like, that doesn't make sense at all, except David is trying to make a better connection for us. That for us to have that connection, we need to wait on the Lord. That we need to allow that relationship to be built and to be developed. In other words, that strength and that courage doesn't come from our own strength. It comes from the God that wants to know you, that wants to be in relationship with you. And so with Psalm 27, David gives us this beautiful picture of faith that almost, as I got done studying, it almost left me a little bit nervous about preaching because, you know, as a preacher, I love for you to leave here feeling happy and excited and go live and everything's gonna be great, right? And it will be, but it's gonna be great because of what you've established as the baseline for your life. So here's what I love in this text. David doesn't sell our faith short by minimizing the struggle. He doesn't minimize the struggle. What he does is in verses 9 through 10 is speak to what it looks like to really struggle with our faith. And for David, it's okay to hold confidence and faith in one hand and to cry out in another hand. It's okay to have faith and confidence and belief in God, but still to struggle and to even doubt and hold that in their hand. The two don't cancel each other out. He gives us a faith that makes sense in this world, a world that is so broken and so in need of a God that wants to connect with them. Confidence in God's ability to hold back evil does not mean that we have to hold back the tears. Boy, if you're here today and you think that it is wrong for you to grieve and to be broken when you're walking through difficult things because you feel like it shows a lack of faith in your life, that is the furthest thing from the truth ever. I'm going to tell you that when you understand that you can hold lament in one hand and you can hold faith in another, when you cry and when you grieve, it only builds your faith because it's in these moments that God's goodness will be revealed to you and that your foundation will be further established and held true in Christ. But once again, it means that God has to be that center focus, that the priorities of our life, the priority of our heart needs to be to dwell in the house of the Lord, that it needs to be the presence of God. And I can't stress for you enough that it is so easy for us to allow that foundation to be other things, to allow for it to be our children, or to allow for it to be finance, or to allow for it to be our career, or whatever else. We slide it right into that spot and we allow that to become the ultimate thing rather than God. But doesn't it make sense? Isn't it almost counterintuitive? That if we take the only eternal, the most important, ultimate thing, and we make it the center core of our life, then it will never be taken away from us because it's the only thing that can't be removed. I mean, if your health is ultimately the most important thing to you, I've got news for you. None of us are getting out of this alive. Your children, at some point, they'll disappoint you because they're human. health is going to ravage this world as it has. And if you're focused on that, if you think you can control that, this last 2 years has taught you something completely different. So as a people in this journey, we have to grab a hold of a faith that allows us to believe, but also struggle and experience God in the midst of the struggle. And if we can live life in that way, I'm going to tell you, it'll change everything about how we go forward. You know, one of the questions that comes up sometimes in my men's Bible study is where's the gospel message in all of this? And so you ready for some mental gymnastics? But it's not really. David says, for him, one thing he requests is to live in the house of the Lord all the days of his life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. I can imagine David, his son was the one that got to build the temple. So David maybe didn't get to see it in his full interaction, but he understood temple sacrifice. And if he was to inquire and wonder and process through, he would have recognized the sacrificial system as a way that God intended to or set up so that we could be in connection, that our brokenness and our sin could be dealt with, even in the smallest of ways, with sacrifices that were made. And so for David to see that and to inquire and to wonder, yes, he had the foreshadowing of a greater sacrifice that would ultimately be made, but he would have seen a God that loved him, a God that loved his people and wanted to be in relationship. You may say, Scott, how does that work for us? I think of Jesus in John chapter 2. John puts this story way up at the front. All the other gospels put it at the end, but Jesus goes into the temple and they're selling things in the temple, sacrifices, and he starts to turn over the tables and he gets so frustrated about everything. He says, you've turned my temple into a den of robbers. And so all those around ask him for a sign, and he says, I'll show you a sign. Destroy this temple and I'll rebuild it in 3 days. And they're like, are you crazy? It took 46 years to build this temple. He wasn't talking about the building. He was talking about himself, his temple. And so for us to inquire about the temple, for us to seek his face, is a true connection in the revealing of the heart of God, to make Jesus, to make the revealing of God in our lives the most central, important focus of who we are. And when we dedicate our lives, when we pour our hearts into that, then God helps us to navigate through all of the other challenges and things that we struggle with. If we're going to talk about what it means to flourish, then we've got to become intimately aware of Jesus, intimately aware of God's love for you, God's sacrifice for you, and how much he wants to be in relationship with you. And so today, as we close, maybe you're in a place where you've not thought about a moment to restart or a moment to kind of reset. Maybe today's that moment, that as we go into this fall season, that you want to be a part of God doing something incredible, not just in your life, but in this community. Maybe it's time to say, God, draw me back to the center. Help me to move all of these other things out of my focus, and I want you to be the focus. And maybe you've never made a decision for Christ. That maybe today you say, God, I don't know that I fully even know what I'm saying, but I want to believe. Help me to understand this Jesus. Help me to understand this relationship. I want to begin this journey. And it's just that simple prayer. God, help me to believe in Jesus. And then allow us to come in and pull alongside and maybe move in that relationship. I look forward to seeing what God is going to do in us over these next 6 months. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you just for this opportunity to gather our hearts and to really focus on you. David saw the good, the bad, and the ugly. He saw it all in his life. And so for him to write these words, he knew the messy parts of faith. He knew that the struggle was real. And God, the same is true for us. And so I just pray that you allow us to experience a relationship with you that maybe we've never experienced before, where you become the central focus, where we can seek your face. We can recognize the lines in your eyes and realize why you do what you do, when you do it, not because it gives us what we want, but because it helps us to understand maybe the greater connection, and we can in turn go back and love others in the same way. So God, bring us along in that very same journey. And for those maybe who haven't opened up their heart yet, that maybe today's that day, God, I pray that you start them on a journey that will change their lives forever, being connected to the living God, the eternal God. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Now, as Kyle and Sarah play this final song, I just pray that you would open up your heart and allow the words to really speak to your heart. It's a beautiful song. They prayed about it. They thought about it. And these words spoke to them. And so this is really their prayer this morning. And I just pray that it ministers to you as I know it ministered to them.
In his hands, who has numbered every grain of sand? Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice. Behold our God. Adore him. Behold our King. Nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. Given counsel to the Lord, who can question any of his words? Who can teach the one who knows all things? Who can fathom all his wondrous deeds? Adore him. Behold our King. Nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. Behold our God, seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King. Nothing can compare. Come, let us adore.
You guys. Will you stand with me? Sounds like it's barely raining now, so I'm gonna let you run to your cars. Thank y'all for being here today, and we'll be being mindful of what's going on in Louisiana. We'll be praying for all of our friends, and we'll let you know if we're getting together teams or whatever we do there to help out. And if I can do anything for you, if you need a Bible or you just need someone to talk to, I'll be down front. Would love to connect with you. Heavenly Father, as we go from this place, I just pray that you would lead us and guide us. We love you. And we're not sure how all of that works its way out in life, but God, we want you to be that center focus that helps us to navigate through these challenges, because God, we want to be a part of what you're doing in this world. So use us as such, as the body of Christ. We love you, we trust you, and it's in your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. You guys have a wonderful week. Thank you.